So when we say paga, that means place of cattle or cows. Pikwro means a rocky area. So the camp is located in Nania community. This camp was discovered in 1704 by a local slave trader, someone who was dealing in slaves. Actually, the person was a stranger here. When he came here, the indigenous did not know where exactly he came from. So they gave him a name, Bagao, which means bushman. So the bushman initiated the whole thing here. After he discovered that this place was the only ideal place he could settle and then run his business, the people also gave him such a name, that you are not part of us. Part of us, you are rather a stranger. So bushman was the name given to him. Later on, two others who were also dealing in slaves were invited by that bushman from Burkina Faso and Mali to come and run business with him. So these friends are called Samori and Babatu. So the bosses were three. They were the main people who handled the business up here in the north. But from here, the slaves were bought and taken to Salaga slave market. I'm sure some of you might have been there.
Yes.
So from Salaga to Asin Mansu, where they stopped again to prepare them. That was where they gave their last bath before they approached the castles, either Elmina or Cape Coast Castle. Then finally bought by the whites and shipped to the various foreign countries for cheap labor. Meaning here is the root of the whole business. And these slaves I'm talking about here came from different countries, especially those countries that are located somewhere ahead of Ghana, the sub-Saharan African countries, as well as some from nearby communities of northern Ghana. So the major way of acquiring these slaves was to attack and capture. These three men I mentioned earlier, they were accompanied by so many young men, like army. So they went to different countries like Mali, Burkina Faso, Niger, Benin, attacked and captured people who were physically strong, both males and females, between the ages of 20 and 30. They were mostly targeted at. So anytime they brought them here, the first thing to do was to give them marks, brand them like cows. So after the brand process, the slaves were grouped and chained to these trees around. You can see we have a lot of trees here. The place was a typical bush. It wasn't open as you see today. So by then the vegetation was so thick that even if someone was standing somewhere across the road, the fellow wouldn't know what was going on. So after they chained them to the trees, they would now choose some of them. Among the ladies, four or five were chosen to go and prepare food up there, where we are heading to after this place. We are going to that place. Then there you would see their water source, where water was oozing out from a hole created naturally. So this water was secured for their cooking, drinking, and the rest. Besides the water source, we have their dining hall, where stubborn slaves were made to create holes. They carved out some holes on the rock just to enable themselves their food, like their eating plates. Then from the dining hall to their entertainment center, where they normally entertain slaves after every supper in the evening, especially whenever there was moonlight. That is the place they gathered all of them, divided them into groups, and each group was made of 10 or more. Some of them were drumming, others were singing on the rock, and then the rest were also dancing. So when we get there, fortunately, there are some people who are trained to always demonstrate on these things. And so they will play for you to see the way the Kasana slaves in particular were doing during those days. then from there to their market, where slaves were actually sold out to these retailers who were coming from the rest of the African continent, some parts of Ghana, especially the coastal areas. And they were just assembling them like the way you people are assembled here, for the buyers to normally make the selection before they would now exchange for some commodities. You know, it was part of the trade. So they were not buying them with money, rather gunpowder, including gin, it could be cowries or beads, even tobacco for a slave. Then from that point, we proceed to their watchtower, where you will see the highest rock in the camp. And on that rock was a security man taking charge of intruders and then escapees. Then from the tower down some few meters, you see their cemetery, where they buried all slaves who lost their lives through this hardship. They were buried in mass graves. I think some of the graves are still there, indicated with some stones. Then close by the cemetery is a punishment store, where the masters normally punish stubborn slaves who sometimes try to escape but failed. Others also attempted to rape the female ones, or they beat their buttocks sometimes. All these people were taken to that place, made to sit on the rock for some kind of severe punishment to serve as a deterrent or an example to those who were witnessing it. This action all took place from 1704 to 1845. Any questions before we go?
First year. The stubborn ones were creating
the boots. It was like some form of punishment to those who were stubborn to dig out their own plates.
It's already there.
The whole, no, it isn't there. You have to carve it out because you are stubborn. The masters had their own boats. Yes, were made of clay and sometimes something like mud.
We might be doing that, so some of the instruments they use for entertainment.
The only instruments they use are what we are going to see. So when we get there, you see the instruments.
Okay.
If it's okay, then we can start moving.
Okay.
Let's do that.